Thank you, Sandra, and thank you, Tim. Thank you, everybody here at Quail Ridge Books for hosting us tonight. I'd like to welcome you all to our monthly series, and thank you for coming. My name is Stacy Cochran. As most of you know, I'm the organizer for the Raleigh Write to Publish group. It's about 1,000 member strong writers group who we have a bunch of stuff going on every month that you can find out about, both the monthly series, a critique group. We've got open mic nights, all kind of stuff to get involved with. I do want to mention one thing. On February 21st, that'll be our next major panel discussion. We're going to have a panel with Elisa Lorello and Adam Shepherd. How many folks here have heard of either Adam or Elisa? A few of you. We have Elisa with us tonight. So that panel discussion is going to be on self-publishing. The decision to self-publish or not to self-publish is one that I think a lot of writers have to face. So we're going to meet it front and center on February 21st here at Quail Ridge Books. So mark your calendars for that. A couple of other preliminary things that I need to mention here tonight as well. Patty drove up all the way from Charlotte to be here, and so we want to take up some donations at the end of the event tonight. I have a tip jar. If you want to throw in 10, 20, 100 bucks, you know, we've got a tip jar here to put a couple of bucks in to pay for gasoline, as well as to pay our folks a little bit of an honorarium for tonight for being here. So please, at the end of tonight's event, please do that. In addition to that, we do have their books on hand as well. Patty's got a couple of books that the store has ordered, Katrina's Wings and Painted Dresses. I'll get a copy of those passed around in just a minute. And then Linda has a book as well, whose title I'm not even going to try to make it all the way through, but I'll pass both of these, or all three of these, around in just a minute. They'll be signing afterwards, and I think we're going to set up Sandra maybe back here. So they'd be happy to sign books for you.
Absolutely.
As well. Finally, one last thing before I introduce the panelists tonight. Because of the size of the crowd, I think the best way to take questions is via note cards. So what I'm going to do is I'll pass around note cards. Some of you are familiar with me doing this in the past. If you have a question for either of the panelists, what I want you to do is write your question and your name, if you want your name announced as well, on the note card, and then I'll read through those after we get through about 8 prepared questions that I have here. So I have these note cards, which I'll pass around in just a couple of minutes as well. Just put your name, if you want me to announce your name when I ask the question, and whatever question you have for the panelists as well. Everybody got that?
Stacy?
Yes.
Can we talk about the clocks?
Oh, and we have some clocks as well. Mm-hmm. So at the conclusion of tonight's event, we're going to have some sort of drawing or giveaway for a couple of these writer's clocks. And as you can see here on the clocks, I don't know how well you can see it out in the audience, but we have, it says publish at noon, write at 1, write at 2, toss at 3, retrieve at 4, start over at 5, writer's block at 6. You get the idea. So we'll have a couple of these clocks to give away at the conclusion of tonight's events. Well, a little bit about our panelists. At my far left here, your far right, we have Linda Rohrbaugh.
Yay! Make sure.
My fan club. Thank you.
Linda has been writing professionally since 1989 and has more than 5,000 articles and 7 books to her credit.
Wow.
She has received awards in both fiction and nonfiction, including 3 national awards. Her most recent book, Weight Loss Surgery with the Adjustable Gastric Band, which is the book that we have here, co-authored with Robert Sewell, MD, was published by DeCapo Lifelong Books in March 2008. Linda has several how-to articles on the NC Writers Network website. Visit her website at lindarohrbaugh.com. So that's Linda, and I'm reading this actually from the North Carolina Writers Network newsletter, so I hope these bios are sufficient. And then Patty Hickman is here somewhere. Patricia Hickman is a communicator and award-winning author. of fiction and nonfiction whose work has been praised by critics and readers alike. Patty first studied creative writing at the University of Arkansas at Little Rock and then went on to do graduate studies in writing at Queens University. She writes for major publishers and is currently at work on her 16th book for Random House. Pain Addresses was released in July 2008 to critical acclaim. She has served as an adjunct writing professor at UNCC and teaches in writing workshops across the country. Patty is the chairperson and founder as well of the Secret Angels Project, benefiting North Carolina families with HIV and AIDS. Thank you very much for joining us here tonight. How about a round of applause, folks? So the format for this, most of you are familiar with this. I've got a few questions that I'd like to get started with, and then we'll open it up to your questions as well. The first question that I have, of course, is I want to talk a little bit about publishing and marketing. And I'm going to toss this to both of you. Patty, why don't you get us started? How would you characterize the state of publishing at the start of 2009? Given all the economic crises that we're under, how would you characterize the state of publishing?
Well, I think that everyone has been a little nervous about any industry that any of us are working in, and certainly publishing is not immune from that. I think that according to some national newspapers that talked about publishing that was just released a couple of weeks ago, U.S. News and World Report, and I think the other one may have been the New York Times, both published articles in which there was a lot of excitement about publishing and how we had fared through the holidays. Of course, a lot of that has to do with a particular novelist by the name of Stephanie Meyer. But you know, those leaders we really appreciate out there who are bringing interest again back to all of our bookshelves over in fiction. I think that fiction has had some more positive forecasts over the past few weeks and few years. I write for a market. Actually, I'm a crossover writer. I have a faith-based fiction foundation, but I crossed over in with some hybrid fiction and began writing for Warner Books and Random House a few years ago. And for the last few years, faith-based fiction has certainly been leading the pack in publishing. And so there's been a lot of very positive forecasts for publishing, but they're always looking for the next new voice. If you're a writer, you're an emerging writer, and you have that, there's always an editor out there that's looking for something that's very different, that's potent, that's wonderful, that resonates and has all these great transcendent elements in them. And so I feel very positive about it. My publisher keeps asking me for more novels, and so far so good. It's every month you just wonder if you're going to wake up and still be writing, and I'm just fortunate enough so far that keeps working for me.
Linda, how about you? How would you characterize it any differently? Have you seen anything that sort of contradicts that, agrees with it?
You know, what I keep getting asked about, because I have my computer background, is e-books. Everything's going to go to e-books. We're not going to have paper books anymore. I have the privilege of having been around when the VCR came out. You guys remember that? Remember how they said we're never going to go to the movie theater again? Did that happen? No. What happens is these new technologies open up new realms for us. So, like, there are videos now that made money in DVD and VCR, you know, VHS format that would have never made money if they'd have been limited to a movie theater or a television broadcast. And I think there's a whole new world opening up in publishing. A lot of small presses are doing extremely well. Of course, the excitement about readers are up, book sales are up. You know, I think there's always room for somebody who's good. And, you know, as tragic as it is, some of the people I love have died, like John Updike died recently. Somebody's got to fill those shoes, folks. Somebody maybe from here. So I'm really optimistic. Of course, you know, I tend to be optimistic. But I love books. I love publishing. I love writing. I love reading. And I don't know that that's going to go away.
Very good. I got a couple of questions sort of geared towards paths to publishing for aspiring writers. And now you both have published fiction and nonfiction, but the books that we have here tonight, Patty's got a couple of novels, and Linda, you've got a couple of nonfiction books, so I thought it would be cool to address both of those. Patty, what paths would you recommend to publication for anybody who's interested in writing and publishing novels?
Well, I don't want to give you a formula, because I don't want you to take that formula and then try it out and it doesn't work for you, and then you think, oh, well, this is not never going to work for me. I encourage you to look for any sort of door that you can break into. I have some online friends who are all published novelists. There's 200 of them. Every single writer has a different path to publishing. Mm-hmm. But of course, the boilerplate is that you attend writers' workshops, that you talk to agents, that you listen to, if you're writing fiction, that you go to and you attend writers' workshops from people who've been there, done that, and just keep building your network and your circle of friends. In fiction, eventually you are going to need some sort of an agent, and so your networking is very important, the friends you make. But I have a philosophy that I maintain, and it's that I have never looked at anyone that I meet in publishing as someone that's going to be a rung in my ladder on my way up. I'm always looking for a new friend. And every time I go to a writer's workshop or a festival or an event like this, I'm always looking for some new friends out there, which is why I have a little newsletter thing you can put your email on if you want to. But I just like to stay in touch with people, because the richest part of publishing for me has been the friends that I make. And so I encourage you just to make as many friends as you can who are book lovers like you, because those are the people that you're going to take with you for the rest of your life, and who are going to be your forever friends no matter what, whether you're published or not. And so just network, but always look at each person that you meet. Is this someone who I can sit down to coffee with, or sit down and just talk about books until midnight, and just enjoy the ride, enjoy the journey.
Very good. I do want to mention Linda's book. I should have mentioned the title before. The title is Weight Loss Surgery and the Adjustable Gastric Band, Everything You Need to Know Before and After Surgery to Lose Weight Successfully. I'll get a copy of this passed around. You have written a number of, kind of self-help, nonfiction type books. How many folks in the audience are thinking about publishing or writing that kind of book? Sort of nonfiction, potentially self-help. We've got a few people here. What paths to publication would you recommend for them? What kinds of things should they be doing if they want to see their book in print?
Okay, well, the first thing I'd say is persistence. You know, and that's what I keep hearing from the people who have made it. It's not about talent, it's about persistence. It's about staying with it. There's a talent, my friend Debbie Maycomber will tell you, talent is on every street corner, and it is. But the people who can stay with it are the ones who make it. If I were you, I'd write for anybody who let me. And I still write for free. When I was in LA and decided I wanted to start writing about computers, I wrote for free for 3 years for computer user groups. And nobody paid me. And the first article I wrote, I was so scared I didn't spell check it, and they didn't either. So, you know, but they asked me to write another one. And you know, you've got to find a place where you can contribute. You've got to find your voice. The only way that stuff happens is by getting out there and doing it. And let me tell you where the easiest paths to some of these places are. My saying is, where there are problems, there are opportunities. There are no problems, there are no opportunities. The people who have the biggest problems finding writers to write for them are nonprofit groups with newsletters. How many of you are a member of a writer's group? Okay. The writer's groups have a terrible time finding anybody to write for their newsletter. Did you know that? And I don't know, we're all writers. You'd think, you know, they'd all be jumping up and down, but they're not. So find a space to write in, and I would suggest join any kind of computer group would work, but any kind of nonprofit group, but especially writers groups, and go to the newsletter editor and say, do you have any trouble getting submissions? They will love you. And start writing. And then let the paths open up from there.
That's a great idea. In fact, I've been thinking about starting a newsletter for the Raleigh Write to Publish group. If anybody's really interested in helping me do that, talk to me afterwards. We'll get a newsletter going. It'll be a little bit more formal than my emails that I send out from time to time. So, and it's a great point. I think, you know, that's a good way to have a little bit of visibility. It's all about exposure, visibility, and folks recognizing your name in multiple places. Let's talk a little bit about, I do want them to do a reading. We're going to have them do a reading in a minute or two here. But Patty, let's start talking a little bit about literary agents. Okay. First, what does a literary agent do? And then how do writers find the right one?
All right, that's, again, every novelist I know is going to have a different story about how they found their agent. Your first question, though, is what do they do? And that's very important. agents are not editors, and they expect that by the time that you bring something to them, that it has been edited to death, been revised to death, and that you're going to bring them your very, very best work. So please look at them as someone who's not going to help you refashion your book or help you revise it. By the time you bring it to them, they want it to pop. They want it to explode or do something, you know, very volatile when they read it in their heart. And so they want it to look, you know, wonderfully gorgeous. They just want the writing to be very gorgeous. And but what they do is they take your book and they pitch it to the publisher, and they won't do that unless they passionately believe in the book. And so that plays into you finding the exact type of agent that you want. Now, in faith-based fiction, there's one huge agent, but then there's a lot of other smaller ones that have come along. Is anyone here interested in faith-based fiction? A few of you? Okay, all right. Those agents, Alive Communications is one that's been very big, and they've represented me for very many years. But what I was looking for in an agent is someone who felt very passionately about the particular type of women's fiction that I was writing for. My writing is very emotional. It has sort of a literary bent to it. It has sort of a hybrid or a crossover or book club audience that it reaches out to. And I needed an agent who really felt passionate about that. I shopped several agents, probably several, 12 agents. We emailed each other back and forth. They loved my bio, but I didn't find exactly that right one that was feeling as passionate as I felt that they should feel about my next writing endeavor. And so then a friend of mine, who I'd been friends with for years, had recommended her agent. Her name is Francine Rivers. And her particular agent and I had met before, had liked each other, and so we began emailing. I told her I was looking for a new agent again. And she looked at four different manuscripts that I sent to her. And there was one that she absolutely loved. And we talked about it. And I could just tell in talking back and forth that she felt very passionate. And then she began forecasting right over the phone. Now, this is the type of readers you have. And I hadn't defined my readers to her at all. But she had read enough of my books and liked them that I could tell that she was feeling as passionate about my writing that I was. And so we talked. It was obviously going to be something very relational. I wanted it to be long-term. It is like a marriage. And when your agent doesn't work out or it falls apart, it's like a divorce. Mm-hmm. It's just like leaving your publisher is almost a divorce. But leaving your agent, just it certainly feels like that. You become very attached to them. So when you find that right agent, you're just going to know it. In the beginning, of course, and I know that feeling, you just want anyone who's willing to take you on and shop it. But definitely you want them to feel passionate about you. You want them to be a little bit hungry, not so over, you know, not so bloated in all of their clients that they represent that they don't have time to answer your emails. And so you want someone who has a lot of time for you and focuses on you and wants to plan out 6 years or 10 years out and wants to forecast what your career might look like 10 years from now so that you can keep publishing over and over and over. That's the goal.
I do want to get to you guys' questions as well. Has everybody gotten a note card to write a question down on? Does anybody need a note card? So if you would, again.
We don't have anything.
Okay, I've got some more.
We have these identified.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Just write on the back of these. And we'll pass this forward in a minute or two. Well, I guess a question then, Linda, for you is what I wanted to ask was, well, do writers need a literary agent? In every instance, does everybody need a literary agent?
Well, I was an agented for a long time. And I had an agent in the very beginning, and he didn't place my book. And we didn't have a good relationship. And if I told you his name, you'd know who he was. But this is a real small world, so we don't go there. But the bottom line is, I think you do. And here's why. How many of you know who Andy Rathbone is? You know anybody? How many of you know those Dummies books for Windows? Andy Rathbone, okay? Best-selling computer book author of all time. A colleague of mine. We started writing about the same time. We'd enter contests. I take first, Andy takes second. Andy had an agent, and I had that one for a while, and that didn't work out. And so Andy kept inviting me to these conferences, and where the agents at that time held conferences and had writers come. And I said, you know, Andy, if I go to that conference, I'm going to get an agent. And I don't know, I'm selling myself, I'm doing okay. I don't know that I need an agent. So I didn't go. And what happened is I broke my back in a car accident, almost lost my writing career. My book got orphaned. The editor that acquired the book and had the vision for the book moved on somewhere else. They moved the book to another part of the country. That editor didn't like me or the book. So there were a lot of problems, all of which an agent would have helped me with had I had one, but I didn't have one. So now, Andy is best-selling a computer book author of all time. We're talking 15 years later, and I'm here and I'm still working, but I'm not where Andy is. I think you need an agent. You know, I think you do. Your book, there are things that are going to happen. The agent can tell you which way the wind's blowing. They talk to the publishers. You want to be connected, of course, with other writers. But I think you really, if you're going to do this for a living and you're serious about it, I think you need to get an agent. Now, having said that, I've got to tell you, it's taken me really a long time. Nonfiction agent took me about a year. Fiction agent took me 5 years to find. I've had agents wanted to represent me, but it didn't work. You know, it didn't work for. There was one Harvard graduate, lovely woman, selling real well. I could not understand her accent. She was raised out of the country, and one of my writer friends put me in. I spent the whole evening with her. It was obvious to me she wanted me to pitch to her. I think she would have represented me. I thought, if I can't understand her in person, how's this going to work on the phone? You know, so. You know, there were times where I got turned down. I loved them. They didn't love me. There were other times they loved me. I didn't love them. And I can tell you, too, I've had agents say, who turned me down, that I'm friends with because they're like, for example, Andrea Brown's husband is my writing buddy. And Andrea said, you know, I'm thinking about taking you on because Dave likes your work so much. But she turned it down when I submitted it. And she said, we had two people in the office read this and we didn't want to do it. And because she knows me, you know. So we're sitting at dinner and she's going to do, you know, she's thinking about taking me on. And I thought, is this going to work? She likes me. She doesn't like the work. You know what? And I almost went there. The agent I have now, we're okay. We like each other. But he loves my work. And I got to tell you, of the two, you want the guy to like your work or whoever's going to represent you to love what you're doing and feel passionate about what you're doing and get it. And so I think, you know, it's gonna be a path because everyone can tell you that it's easier to get a publisher right now than to get an agent. But I have, because of my past experience, decided I was no longer going to be non-agented in anything I sold anymore. I was going to have an agent. And that's my decision. And you've got to do what works for you. I'm saying, I think you need one.
Very good. I want to take up the note cards as we're beginning to do this reading. I would love to hear you guys do a little bit of reading from your books. I'm sure the audience would like to hear a little bit as well.
Sure.
So would you like to read a little bit, Patty, from Pain and Dresses?
Sure, I'll be glad to do that. Painted Dresses is a kind of a Thelma and Louise type of story, if you remember that old movie. It's about two sisters who are on the road and on the run from a drug dealer who actually is from this area. And these are good old North Carolina redneck sisters. And the oldest sister, Galen, has been trying to distance herself from her redneck roots and her family, but her father's death, her mother has already died. Her father's death brings her back home again to the funeral and to also have to take over the responsibilities of enabling her very problematic sister, Delia. The girls have just been to the funeral. They've just found also that they've inherited $250,000. And the oldest sister is very worried about handing over some money to the younger sister. The father set up a trust fund. That means that she's going to have to look out after this sister the rest of her life. She has taken her back to her sister's trailer, where they've found that the electricity has been turned off. She has a lot of unusual pets, of which she has taught them all to do various household chores so that she doesn't have to do them. Delia's a real piece of work. And so this is where we find them in the trailer home. And Delia is just beginning to think, I'm almost rid of her, and I'm going to put her in Dad's house and leave her behind. And this is where we find Galen as they are in the trailer. And Galen's saying to her, I'm going to help you take care of the checkbook. And she's promising her all kinds of anything she wants just so she can get rid of her. It takes time, I said. I opened the window blinds but yanked too hard. The blinds came loose from the frame and clattered to the floor. Who cares? Asked Delia. The landlord can burn it all down, far as I'm concerned. Delia lifted another blind and looked out. My neighbor kept Porter overnight, my dog. I couldn't stand to leave a new pup here in the dark. I'll fetch him after I get my things.
She pulled her clothes off the hangers in the closet. She handed each piece to me, I assumed, so that I could fold them. I held up the first shirt. "This is a man's shirt, Delia," I said. "I've been living with a man. Freddie, he wouldn't let me buy a stitch of clothes. That left me to wear nothing but his things." She unzipped her jeans and opened her fly. "But I love him, so what was I to do?" "You're wearing men's underwear," I said. "It's all I had," she said. "All he give me." "Are any of the clothes in this closet yours?" I asked. "Nothing but a few bras." She held up a bra, yellowed and stretched thin. "We'll go shopping then." A loud noise shook the trailer. I braced myself against the wall, thinking the entire place might cave in. "Someone's beating my door down, sounds like," said Delia. I told her to keep throwing out the men's clothes, that I would get the door. A woman about 30, black, and about to pound the door down, stepped away when she saw me. I looked at her inquisitively, trying to smile. "I come looking for Delia Cheatham." Cheatham was Delia's name by her first husband. "Am I at the wrong place?" She was frowning and trying to see around me. Suddenly, a burst of feathers and clucking from inside the trailer startled her. She backed away, least when her chicken wanted to escape the dark trailer prison. "It's a pet," I told her. I let least one out the door and into the yard. She was a spare woman, dressed too thinly for the chilly weather. When I didn't answer her question about Delia, she backed down the stairs, looking at me mistrustfully. "If you see her, she's the hoe that tried to take my husband. He's been living two lives, one at my place and one here, until today. But it's over now. Tell her." Glad to hear it. I was about to close the door, but the pain in the woman's eyes made me continue to stare after her. It was the kind of curiosity that made my expression appear obliging. But really, my fascination with Delia's life just made me stare. Here was a woman I might never have met if I had not been placed at that instant on my sister's threshold. "If I see Delia, may I tell her who asked after her?" I asked. "Sophie Deals, Freddie Deals' wife. Delia knows Freddie, that's for sure." Delia whispered down the hall. "Tell her to get lost." "Delia Cheatham, you come face me." Sophie cocked her head to one side. She smirked and planted one clear Aquila kill on the first porch step. "You hiding, ain't you? You know you broke up my marriage." "Shut up, Sophie!" Delia yelled, but she wouldn't come out. Sophie tromped back up the stairs, her long arms pulling her up by the porch rails toward me. I wanted to calm her and send her on her way. "Please, Mrs. Deals, I'm sure Delia's got no reason to fight with you. If you just take some time to cool off, I'll talk to her and see what she can do to make it right." Sophie's eyes softened. She pursed her lips, pausing, still straining to see around me. "You think you can get her to make things right?" she asked, as surprised as if I was fresh as flowers off the farm. "Only way she can do that is to keep away from my Freddie. We got four kids to bring up, and she don't care nothing about that. Maybe you can talk to her." "I will," I promised. "She's moving away, if that helps." Sophie acknowledged me with a slight nod. "Good, then. Can't believe my husband got tangled up with the likes of her anyhow." She was standing out in the yard and was pretty well on her way off Delia's property when she muttered, "Everybody knows she's crazy. Who knows why Freddie went slumming?" She turned to walk back to her car. Delia yelled from inside, "Shut your face, Sophie! He don't love you anyway!" Sophie turned and yelled, "Your life ain't worth squat from this time on. You watch your back, Delia Cheatham." I walked out onto the porch to be certain she was leaving. I took the steps down to the last boarded landing, continuing to force a smile anytime Sophie glanced back at me. I didn't see the door come open and the butt of my father's rifle lift over my head. Delia yelled, "I'm not standing for this," and then pulled the trigger. I fell onto the bottom porch step. The rifle fire was as deafening as it had been out in the deer woods with my cousin Tim, but overhead it seemed to take all the sound out of the air, out of my ears, as if no sound was left in the world. Sophie fell against the car. I clambered up the steps before Delia could unload a second round. I forced the rifle butt into the air. Delia was laughing. Sophie gunned her engine, pulling out onto the dirt road, gravel spangling my car like wedding rice. Reassured that Delia did not just murder her boyfriend's wife, I said, "What a relief! I thought you got her." I leaned against the railing, trying to regain my senses. I did. She was bleeding like a knifed hog. I stared after Sophie, but she kept driving until her car was out of sight. She won't come messing around here no more. How'd you get Daddy's gun in the first place? Tim stored it in the gun rack, and I put it in the back of your car, bent inside that steamer trunk you give me. I heard she was coming to whip me. You'll go to jail, Delia! Her smile disappeared. Sophie's brother's a low-life drug dealer. The Freemans don't go to the cops for nothing. I heard of Mason Freeman. Back of the page, the News and Observer, Mason Freeman. He did time in prison after turning down a drug deal with a Wilmington judge to snitch on a fellow drug-dealing relative. Dust lifted from the unnamed lane in front of Delia's trailer. Go and pack what little you need, Delia. We've got to get you away from here. Go! Go! I meant to the police, but the road never took us in that direction. Paint addresses.
Patty Hickman. I do want to get the cards moving forward. If you would just pass them to the front row and then kind of towards the center, that would be great. I can take them up. So what would you say, Patty, is the key to these characters? I mean, are these people you know? How do you write characters like this? Or is it kind of a composite of folks?
Now, Stacy, as you know, there is nobody that in any of my books that are actual persons in real life. But of course, I grew up in Arkansas, and I grew up in a very difficult family. And my parents were, as our neighbor said, one brick shy of load. I had to learn at a very early age what that meant. My father had a bipolar disorder, and my mother had a lot of neurosis. And then I won't talk about anyone else in my family who's living right now. But sure, there are people in our lives that inform our writing. But what happened with Painted Dresses and the way that it came to be, just real quickly, is as I had submitted a book called A Boy Erased from My Life to the Queen's University MFA program, and I had already had 12 or 13 books published. I just wanted to become a better writer and had submitted that, and had also shown it to my agent at the time. And I was accepted into the program, but I had a wonderful thesis advisor by the name of Elisa Chappelle, who writes for Salon and Vogue, and she's been part of an anthology called Use Me, New York Times bestselling author. And she and I just talked and talked over the things that were very real in my life that were coming out of the story. But at the same time, I had also sent off to a prison where we had found my half-brother, who I'd never really known. He was the boy erased from my life. We found him in prison, and he was serving time in a medium security prison for 13 counts of as a child predator. And so as the story began to unfold, I began to understand a lot of things were coming back to me with regressive memories and night terrors and all sorts of things. And I began searching through and sort of a road trip by phone through all of my aunts who were still living since my parents had passed on, and finding out a story about my own painted over life. And so my story is informed by real life in many ways. But as Elisa told me, it had to take on a life of its own. And so the Thelma and Louise story that emerged is sort of a metaphor of my own life about the road trip that I took to understand the pain and the journey and sort of the pain my mother had to go through when she evicted my brother from the home when I was 4 years old, and the decision that she had to make between two children, her Sophie's choice that she had to make in order to protect my sister and I. And so while this is a painful story, it's also a story of humor and has a redemptive theme in it.
Mm-hmm. And that's the skill that I see in this is, you know, you write with this compassion for these characters. This is not a, you know, I have a chip on my shoulder that I want to lay it out on this family about. It's you kind of write to understand them,
yes,
with compassion. And I think that's really what makes it so humorous at times. And I think that's what one of the things that I see separates a lot of aspiring writers, fiction, from ultimately the writers who publish, is that difference between approaching the work with a certain amount of openness, compassion,
and a willingness to want to understand who these characters are and their trials.
That's exactly right. And the one thing that you have to have, and my first breakout novel when I decided to stop writing for, I guess, the market, which was Katrina's Wings, the first thing that I had to have toward all of my characters was a humility for the characters, and that meant I had to have a lot of forgiveness in my life for other people. And I think the first thing that any good writer has to have, especially if you aspire to write books as honest as John Updike or Ann Tyler or Sue Monk Kidd, that you have to have a benevolence for your characters because you have a benevolence for the people that you know. And forgiveness plays into that. And it just helps your... You're not taking your books out on anyone, you know. You're not using your writing. It's not cathartic. You're not trying to embarrass anyone in your family or anyone that you know or your, you know, yourself. But you just have a benevolence for everyone in life, and there's a lot of love that you have to have for people in general. I feel you have to love people to write.
Very good. You're here. Linda, would you like to read a little bit from your book?
Yeah. Do we have it?
I have a copy.
I should have brought my copy in. Thank
That's
you.
That's the big question.
And let's go ahead and get the cards coming up. Is this it? These are the only questions? Okay.
Thank you.
If you have any questions, feel free to pass them on up.
You know, this book, I was, I'm the first one of Dr. Sewell's early patients, and I weighed more than 350 pounds at one point. I don't know what my top weight was. Pretty close probably to 400. I would have never sat in this chair. I know I would have broken it, assuming I could even get into it. I was wearing the biggest size Line Bryant made, you know, that kind of thing. And I remember when I met Dr. Sewell, he said, "This isn't your fault." You know, I didn't believe him, because I really thought that obesity was a character defect. And probably a little bit of a product of being a writer, because we sit, right, and that sort of thing. So, but then one day, about 2 years out, I was 2 years out with the band, I was doing really well, and a friend of mine, who's also a good friend of Dr. Sewell's, brought me into Dr. Sewell's office with all my computer books, because Dr. Sewell's network wasn't working. His staff was having to re-enter data 4 and 5 times. And she said, "Linda can help you with your network and help you get your data set up and get your server right." And he looked at that stack of books on the table and he said, "Do you want to write a book together?" So,
fantastic.
You know, and I don't know about you guys, but as a professional writer, I probably get 3 or 4 offers a month of people who come to me and go, "We want to write a book," or "Here's what I love."
Sure.
"Well, I have an idea. You write it and we'll split it.
The money."
You ever hear that? Yeah, yeah. Never heard that before. So you get those deals. And
right.
But Dr. Sewell I actually took up on, because he said to me, he said, "Obesity is a disease and it's killing people. Cancer is related to obesity, although most people when they get cancer stop worrying about their obesity and worry about the cancer. And I'm convinced that the cancer treatments the cancer treatments work on cancer because people get so sick, they get so thin. Have you seen people with cancer treatments? They look terrible. I had a couple of lumps in my thyroid glands, and two on each gland. And recently my endocrinologist scanned those glands, and I've lost probably another 13 pounds this year alone moving to Raleigh, because I was living in Dallas, and Dallas all you do is shop and eat. So in Raleigh, there are other things to do. And so I lost another 13 pounds. And she scanned those thyroid glands and said, "Linda, the lumps are gone. All those precancerous lumps we were worried about are gone." And she said, "You know, I think there really is something to this obesity in connection with cancer." And she said, "You know, the National Center for Disease Control, who's studying obesity and says obesity is the biggest problem in our country, has their cancer division is starting to exclusively study obesity, the links between obesity and cancer." So Dr. Sewell and I sat down. Now, Dr. Sewell is a doctor. You ever try to talk to your doctor? You know, I mean, it's usually pretty one-sided. He tells you what to do, and you lie to him, and you do it or not, you know. But, I mean, you know, it's real funny, too. They expect everybody to lie. It's like, House? You know, everybody lies? These guys really think that. So when he tells me something, I don't lie to him, so he doesn't always believe me. But we sat down to do this book, and he said, "Here's what I want to do, and here's, you know, how I want to do it." And I said, "That won't work. Here's what we need to do." And we fought like we were married. His staff would kind of listen down the hall to us fighting over how we were going to do this book, you know. So anyway, my deal, it took him 3 years. Doc wrote all the parts that are the medical parts. I wrote the case studies, the dietitian interviews, the psychologist interviews, all that stuff. The theme of this book is dieting doesn't work. And I wanted the stories, people's stories, you know, what they went through, how they suffered with this disease that essentially everybody views as a character defect. So, and Dr. Sewell, he didn't want the stories. So we came in over on the book when we finally got done after 3 years. And he said, they're going to cut your case studies. You watch. They're going to cut them. We turned it, they said, turn it in the way it is. We're 50% over the manuscript. Turn it in the way it is. Do you know the publisher didn't cut one of my case studies? Not a single word. But they cut a whole bunch of his drawings. So that's how it went down. But let me read you, I want to read you a story. I wrote all these, and my story's in here if you want to know about my story and what I went through and how I almost lost my writing career. That's in here too. Let's see. I'm trying to find this one woman, who she had diabetes. And I should have looked this up before I got in here, Stacy. This is would have been good. They took out in cutting things. They took out the table of contents where I had everybody's story right up at the beginning. She had diabetes, and her doctor had given up on her, and told her pretty much, you're at the end of the line. And he said, I can't treat you anymore. Because I don't want to watch you die. And so that's the one I'm trying to find in here. Let's see. Well,
briefly, I can kind of keep things rolling while you're looking that up.
Great, thank you.
I do want to remind everybody that on February 21st, we'll have our next major panel discussion. It's going to be a self-publishing panel discussion. So if you're on the fence about what to do with your book, if you sent it out and you haven't gotten feedback from a traditional publisher and you're considering self-publishing your book, we'd love to have you come to that on Saturday, February 21st. I'm beginning to firm up the next event for March, and I can tentatively say that we've got the publicity director and the marketing director, two different folks from Algonquin Books, on tap for March 21st. So if you're really eager to find out information on marketing a book, we're going to have two of the best guys locally in the business on marketing and publicizing your work. Hey, Henry, it's good to see you. Maybe we can get Henry to speak on the panel on self-publishing here in a month or so. We'll chat afterwards. So we've got those two things coming up, February 21st and then March 21st. And then we already have another panel scheduled or one speaker scheduled for April. I think it's going to be April 18th. So those are a couple of things that we have coming up. How many folks here are familiar with the meetup site, the Raleigh Write to Publish meetup site? So just about everybody. If you're not, we have a website where all of our events are announced. It's writers.meetup.com/500. Maureen Shabani is in the audience tonight. She heads up one of the open mic nights. And we have a critique group that meets monthly, so if you want to get feedback on that, we have a number of other events as well. Again, that's writers.meetup.com/500.
Well, you know what? I don't know that I'm going to be able to find it. I think I'm just going to go ahead and read Dawn's story. Dawn is an amazing public speaker. He has been a consultant to the President of the United States, and he looked like Humpty Dumpty when I met Dawn. Let me see if I can find it. If you get the book and you want to take a look, it's Pat's story is the one where her doctor said, I'm going to give up on you. Okay, here we go. Dawn's story. Dawn's an amazing guy. And his picture's in here. I don't know if you can see it. He looks like Humpty Dumpty.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I'm a lifetime fatty. As a Cub Scout, I had a 32-inch waist. I spent my entire adult life weighing between 300 and 400 pounds. I fly a lot and often first class. I was flying first class on an international trip and had to move to coach where I could get the armrest up so I could use two seats. If I ever wrote a book about weight loss, I plan to call it Too Fat for First Class. I've lost 100 pounds or more on 5 occasions. For example, I got involved in Overeaters Anonymous and lost 165 pounds, went from 320 to 156. I tried a liquid protein diet and lost 100 pounds. I did both Atkins and OA and made it down from 435 to 280. I'm a researcher by trade. About the time Al Roker's gastric bypass hit the news, I started researching weight loss surgery. I checked out over 500 websites. I went to 6 public seminars and interviewed 4 surgeons. If you know Don, he's a nut like that. My decision was motivated by 3 issues: geography, recovery time because of my hectic schedule, and most important, the reputation of the surgeon. I found Dr. Sewell through one of the guys at my Rotary Club and began to explore his reputation with other doctors I knew. What a lot of people don't realize is that other surgeons who come across cases they feel are too risky to handle turn these cases over to Dr. Sewell. One doctor said to me that for laparoscopic surgery, what you want is a great cutter, and Dr. Sewell is a great cutter. By the way, Dr. Sewell is one of the Don is one of the few people that Dr. Sewell allows to call him Bob. He doesn't even let me. I still have to call him Dr. Sewell. I got my band on February 3rd, 2003. Pre-op, I weighed in at 385. I've currently lost over 200 pounds. There have been some stumbles along the way. Dr. Sewell's never been real happy with me because I used calorie methodology, meaning I keep my calorie intake low. So I didn't have that first adjustment for 4 or 5 months. I see the band as a device that keeps me from overeating. I've never had any real hunger pains, but I know Dr. Sewell would prefer I let the band do some of the work and that I lose more slowly. Statistically, 50% of the people who go through weight loss surgery end up having some kind of plastic surgery. I'm into body sculpting, and that's true. On March 4th, 2004, I had a nine-hour surgery in which the plastic surgeon took a strip of 12 inches wide around my middle. Now think about how wide. This book is what, 8? 12 inches around his middle. I went in at 201 pounds, expecting to weigh a lot less than 200 when I came out. But I was dehydrated, so they ended up giving 14 liters of fluid, and I came out weighing 225. However, after healing, I lost 8 inches off my waist, so I made it into a size 38 pants. I was in a size 48 pre-op. I've had less extensive plastic surgery since then, including operations to take care of the other hanging skin areas on my legs, chest, neck, and so forth. It looks like I'll have 4 plastic surgeries altogether before I'm done. I have a couple of observations about my weight loss. One is I'm cold all the time. When you get on the internet, you hear that complaint often from people who have lost a lot of weight. I talked to a neurologist about it, and she also said it would take my body a couple of years to adjust to the new me. I also noticed my weight fluctuates. My lowest weight was 182, but I tend to be somewhere between that and 210, depending on how hard I work on my food choices. Right now, I'm at 208. I also feel that my interpersonal relationships were based on weight, that my personality was shaped by it. I'm a pure type A personality, and I've spent my life compensating. I was the fat man, so I had to prove myself. Now everyone says I'm easier to live with. I'm softer, more mellow. I do know I like myself more. One thing I want to add is that my income has more than doubled since I lost the weight. There are fat bigots out there and prejudice. When I lost the weight, I generated a lot of successful energy from relationships without expending any extra effort. The weight is no longer an encumbrance. Consequently, my income, which was already extremely good, and by the way, Don's a multimillionaire, is just blowing out. He told me his income doubled the first year after he had the surgery. I have more than recovered the money I spent on the band and plastic surgeries with my increased income, meaning that the surgeries have more than paid for themselves. Now I'm normal-looking corporate type. I realized how much the weight was holding me back. I removed a major barrier to my career advancement when I got banded, and I feel terrific about that. The way I see it, the band has a strong potential for economic payoff.
And a roar bow. Well, you guys have got some excellent questions here, so let's get to this. It's about almost 7:30, so why don't we push this until about 7:45, so about another 20 minutes. We'll see how many of these we can get through. If we don't get to your question, I'm sure the folks up here would be happy to answer your question afterwards. We'll try to get through these. These are excellent questions. The first one here is from, it looks like, Robert. Who and how creates demand for your published books? So who creates demand, and how is that done for a published book?
Who creates the demand for it?
Yes, where's demand created for your published book?
Out here.
The demand is created among our readers. Of course, if you're trying to break out of a niche market, which is what I did, and sort of create your own market, that question becomes very potent. When I first started doing it, the answer was I had no earthly idea where I was going to find readers if I was going to cross over. At the time, Southern literary writing was not yet recognized the way it is now. And I think that there were just enough of us novelists out there who ended up banding together
a lot of book clubs rose up. Oprah has really helped us a lot, but some of it seems to be sort of magic. I don't know. But the blogs have really helped me a lot. There was a publicist hired by Random House who was able to get me on what she called a blog tour, and I did not have a lot of faith in it. I just have to tell you that I'd never done that before, and she really had to convince me that that was the thing to
do. What is a blog tour?
A blog tour is a lot cheaper than a book tour because you stay at home and you're answering, you're doing a lot of Q&A, you do your Q&As in advance. You send it back to the bloggers, they post it, they let you know, and you, at the end of the day, you go and see if anyone's interested in what you had to say. And then they also do a critique of your book and let their readers know, oh, you've really got to do this one, it's a thumbs up. My book came out in July the 14th. On July the 31st, Technorati listed Painted Dresses as the number one most talked about book on the internet. And that was over 2 weeks' time. And so that's just one way. I do also blog. If you go to patriciahickman.com, click on Words to Go, I blog. The interest in my blog has picked up since I've started interviewing my writer friends. I was thinking about the wealth of resources I had in writer friends because friendships are so important to me. I have over 200 writer friends who write fiction and also some nonfiction, so I started interviewing them. But I didn't call it really an interview. I called it a coffee chat. Mm-hmm. I had just gotten on Facebook, and you can also please join me on Facebook if you want to. But I started announcing on Facebook to the people who had joined my Facebook group that I was going to be having these chats and that they could chime in. And I was just amazed that suddenly we had people who were interested in what other writers had. They liked the conversation going on between two writers, I guess. And so I'm always out there looking for new ways to find new readers. But with technology the way it is, it's changing all the time. I was not amazed at all to hear that everyone here knew what Meetup was. How many of you are on Facebook? There you go. Does anyone do MySpace? There's not so much on that. I did one just in order to meet a friend that I was trying to meet, and then I dragged her over to Facebook, and she's much happier. And so I think we're getting a lot more attention over in Facebook than we were in MySpace. You figure these things out as you go along, but next month there could be something that will outdo Facebook, so I would definitely keep up with technology.
What would you say, Linda?
Well, I think books,
what creates demand?
Fiction or nonfiction, it's all the same. I think it's about solving a problem. As a reader, I look for books. If I'm reading for pleasure, my problem is I want to feel good when I'm done reading. I want to feel like I've learned something. That's why I read fiction. And the fiction novel, the other fiction novelists that I'm acquainted with, are always trying to solve a problem, make their books relevant to their readers. And so I think, if in a way, writers kind of solve their own problems sometimes through a book. I know you said it's not so much catharsis, but I think for some people it is in a way. First novels are almost always autobiographical and almost always multi-genre as well, which is, makes them tough sells. But I think, it's a problem-solving thing. I want to feel like I'm connected to this character in some way. Or, for example, with this book, Dr. Sewell really believes that he's been put on this planet to help solve the problem of obesity, and I am a partner with him to help solve that problem. And so I dedicated 3 years of my life, and he did too, to getting this book out there. I think that's why I say go find out what you can contribute. Because if you can figure out where you can plug in, other people are going to have the same problem, and then you can help solve a problem for somebody. I think you're doing that no matter what you're writing, though. And I think that's important to keep in mind. How am I contributing? What am I solving? What do I have to say? Because everybody has something to say that's important.
I think that comment about Francine would be good, too.
Go ahead.
Is that all right? Okay. And you're helping me to springboard off of something here also. So thank you. And also, I would like to take a minute to say that as writers begin to share very personal things, it's a very difficult thing to do. And I would like to applaud
you. Oh, yeah,
it's scary. Yeah, I would like to applaud you for sharing your story and for also your success story. And I just want to say yay.
Thank you. You know, it's not a very well-kept secret. Well, in my story, at one point I went to the doctor and the doctor said, you're overweight. And I went, oh, what am I going to tell my family? My friends? You know? I mean, come on. You know, I mean, the stuff people say to you, you can read it in my story when you get that far. But thank you for that.
You're welcome. But many years ago, and I had mentioned Francine Rivers a while ago, she's a dear friend of mine, and if you visit Words to Go on February 13th, we're doing a Valentine's Day talk that day. But Francine and I were in an airport many, many years ago. My son, Jared, my baby, is now a freshman in college, and he was a young little guy at the time, so that tells you how many years ago. But I was having I was very depressed. We had just been to a writer's conference, and it was a book festival also, and it was one in which I didn't feel like that I was fitting in. I had been writing for the market and writing genre fiction, and I had written 5 books for the market, but the more that I wrote, the more my words were crawling outside the boundaries of formula and just swinging from the rafters and doing everything else and driving my editor nuts. And so I said, I'm depressed. I think I'm going to quit writing. And I said, I thought that this was what I wanted, and I just hate it. And she said, well, what is it that you hate? And I said, well, I hate that I'm writing books that I would never want to read. And she said, she said that that's a big problem. And I said, there's these little Southern voices in my head, and none of them sound like anything that anybody else is writing. And she said, here's what you need to do. It's really simple. She said, stop writing for the market. Go home. Quit that. Hang up that hat. And she said, I want you to just sit down and write those little voices that are in your head. Write your book of passion. She said, if you will do that, your readers will find you. And the publishers will want you because your readers are finding you. So I went home and I wrote a little book called Katrina's Wings. And I sent it out, and my current publisher said, we want nothing to do with that. We're not going to be one of those Oprah book kind of publishers, so you're going to have to go out and find another publisher. I was unagented at the time, and I was petrified. I just thought my career's over. And I sent Katrina's Wings out. I had 8 chapters already written. And 2 weeks later, a Random House editor called me, and she was hyperventilating. And she said, yes, I noticed that you're unagented and you're probably shopping this out all over the place. I said, no, I didn't do that. I sent it to you first. And I said, I heard that you were maybe interested in, you know, these hybrid types of books. And she said, oh, good, I want it. I mean, just like that. And we sent it out. We both actually, if you look at the cover of Katrina's Wings, it is full of metaphors. I could sit and show you all sorts of things in it that are just wonderful. But we designed the cover together. And I'm writing for Random House today, and I just keep writing for the voices in my head, for the people out there who want these stories that are very honest and true, and very sincere, and have a benevolence for you, the reader, and a sensitivity for you, no matter who you are, from whatever walk in life, and somehow you found me, and so I don't know. It's again, is it magic? I don't know.
Can I add?
One thing first.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
I do have the sign-in sheet. I want to get this passed around so that I can let you know about upcoming events that we have in the future. There's a blank here for your name and then for your email address, and I have 2 of these. Why don't I start one for the middle section here and then one for this section over here on the side as
okay.
Well. Go ahead, Linda.
I just want to encourage you guys. Have you guys heard about Still Alice? Right? This woman whose book has made the New York Times list, couldn't find anybody to represent it, couldn't find anybody so she self-published it on iUniverse, and people started reading it, and they love it, and Publishers Weekly says it's not very well written. But it's a book about Alzheimer's, about somebody, the first person, going through Alzheimer's. And it's hitting a chord. It's hitting a chord with
right.
people. And so she got $500,000 advance, and wow. Now she's got an agent, and yada, 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 stuff she could never get before. It's just, for me, it's another example of that following your heart mixed with how can I serve my reader, how can I solve their problem.
Well, that segues really nicely into this question here that somebody had asked.
Good segues.
Actually, somebody seriously had asked about self-publishing, and you mentioned iUniverse. The question here is self-publishing a good way to go? So what do you think? What would you say is
I
this
did it on my first book.
Status?
It was really hard. Because then you don't have any credibility. with a bookstore like this, you walk in here and with a box of your books, and it's very difficult to get past that barrier. One of the things that the small presses are dealing with is that whole POD thing, mm-hmm. because the publishing industry right now, and this is shifting, but right now, everything in here is in here on like consignment. These people can send these books back to the publisher at any time, get their all their, you know, and get credit for them, essentially, and that's shifting with bookstores. They get a smaller piece of the pie because of that. They get a lower portion of the than Walmart does. Say if Walmart carries something, Walmart pays for it, but Walmart takes 120 days or 180 days to pay you, so they don't pay for anything till they sell it. The point of that all that is that it's really difficult. It's a difficult road. And so if you think you're going to get out there and it'll be easy and you'll make all the money. I mean, that woman that wrote Still Alice, and I wish I could remember her name, she didn't go with an agent and a publisher because she was making so much money off iUniverse, but she believed in getting it out there. I hear my name. Is someone talking to me? I don't know.
It's those little voices.
iUniverse is an e-book publisher. Cost her about $400 to publish her book through iUniverse, and she developed a following through that, and that following is what has put Still Alice on the map. There are a lot of self-publishing avenues out there. The most popular one that I've heard about is, Books America or... Publish America. And Publish America is expensive, and it's they'll tell you they can get you in bookstores, but they'll be labeled as POD books, and that means because the bookstore can't return them, they won't carry them, essentially. A lot of people are going through the self-publishing route, though, because it's so difficult to get an agent, and it's so difficult to find a publisher these days, and they believe that what they're doing is valid. I self-published my first book. It was called Small Business Computing.